They need a motion to come out of closed meeting.
So moved.
Okay, all in favor? Any opposed? No. Need to certify, Lynchburg City, need a motion to certify that the closed meeting just concluded. Nothing was discussed except the matter specifically identified in the motion to convene in a closed meeting and lawfully permitted to be so discussed under the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act cited in that motion. I have a motion to certify.
So moved.
Second, okay. Need a roll call vote to certify? Ms. Morrison? Ms. Carter? Dr. Coleman?
Yes.
Dr. Dolan-Sewell? Yes?
Yes.
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 Thank you. Okay, so we are out of closed meeting. Need to convene a public budget hearing. This is a required meeting to offer for the public to offer comments to the school operating budget for 2017-18. There were no signups, so if just double checking to make sure there's no one interested in commenting on the public on the budget. If that in that case, then the public budget hearing is adjourned. Now we need to start the public meeting. If we could all rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We need have a need to amend our agenda to add item C2 personnel report, or I'm sorry, to add an addendum to item C2 personnel report and replace the attachment to item G1 policy 2CB-R to CC-R schools guidelines for community resource persons school volunteers. Can I have a motion to amend the agenda?
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No. Thank you. That brings us to item A in our regular board meeting, public comments. We have several individuals signed up to speak. Before I call the first person up, I have a disclaimer to that I need to read. Individuals wishing to address the school board should provide the following information before the start of, I'm sorry, you already did that. Persons appearing before the school board will not be allowed to campaign for public office or promote private business ventures and should not use profanity or vulgar language or gestures, make comments about a public official or an employee that are not related to his or her official duties, engage in behavior that disrupts the meeting or intimidates others, or address the school board on issues that do not concern the services policies, role and or responsibilities of the school board. Individual speakers shall limit their comments to 3 minutes. A speaker representing a group shall limit his comments to 5 minutes. The representative shall identify the group at the beginning of his or her presentation. A group may have no more than one spokesperson. The total allotted time for public comments at school board meetings is 30 minutes. Public comments are reserved for the public to provide input. The board does not respond to comments, answer questions, or otherwise engage in discussion at this time. First up is Dr. Robert Brennan. If you could come up to the podium, please.
Thank you, Dr. Ellis. I will try to follow the guidelines closely. I'm not sure if I am an individual or I am a group. So maybe, do I have 3 minutes or 5 minutes?
You have 3 minutes. You're speaking as a individual.
Okay, thank you. My name is Bob Brennan. I'm a physician, father of 4 boys who went to the public school program, and I'm a relatively new member of the Equity Task Force, and I'm here speaking on their behalf. As you all know, the Equity Task Force was actually established in 2014 following the evaluation of the city schools by the Office of Civil Rights, and it was given several goals, one of which is to work with the administrative staff to improve student achievement, to help close the achievement gap. And the other item which I'd like to discuss tonight is to disseminate information to and interpret information for the community regarding policies, goals, and programs implemented by the school board. Our committee was recently informed that the school board will be discussing tonight the volunteer policy that's on the agenda, and we wanted to make our opinion known as far as our feeling about that policy before there was a discussion and or a vote. There was a letter that was sent to the school board, which I'm sure you all have, and I just want to reiterate three points that are in that letter. One is that the current policy as written does not allow the school administration any flexibility to consider the applications of individuals who have been convicted of a non-violent crime and who have satisfied the court's requirements to volunteer in the school system. We believe that this restricts the consideration of individuals who are no risk to students and would be good mentors and volunteers to the students. Point number two is that although the current policy is used by many school systems in Virginia, there are school districts in Virginia such as Chesterfield and school districts in North Carolina such as Winston-Salem that have adopted more flexible policies where specific crimes are used as criteria to exclude individuals from being volunteers. My last point is that the safety of the students and the Lynchburg City School personnel is of the utmost importance to all of us, and we believe that all volunteers should be appropriately vetted and that the volunteer process should be continuously monitored and evaluated. In closing, I would like to thank the school board for reviewing this policy, and that the Equity Task Force does not have a specific answer to the how it should be adjusted, but we would like to offer our time to work with you all to discuss the policy and see if we can come up with a policy that would be beneficial to our students and respectful to all members of our community. And finally, on a personal note, I'd like to point out that I'm a member of the task force and not a selected spokesman. There are many people who are here tonight and in this room who are much more knowledgeable about this issue and have had much more experience and have been working for many years with the school board to improve our care and our delivery for students in the schools. And several of them are here tonight, including Danny McCain, Eugene Tweedy, Robert Flood, and Reverend Carl B. Hutcherson. I was actually asked by the members of the committee who have been working for many years with the school board to improve the outcomes, to be a new voice for them on this issue. I thank you for your remarkable work and dedication to the school system, and I thank you for being the voice for all of us in the search for a path to success for all students in Lynchburg City Schools. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next is Mr. Robert Flood.
Thank you. I'd like to just kind of piggyback off what he just said. I got documentation that the task force handed out a couple weeks ago, and this is something, you know, it's like a broken record. I've been up here, I don't know how many times, talking about the same issue. It happened 2014 when I realized that if you had a felon on your record, you couldn't volunteer. And I was reading this document that came out, and some of the things I was looking at, it was speaking about the writer of this document provided share meaning for the volunteer coordinator position. Where, put my glasses on, I got a little older. Where I shop the function meaning the following language in the policy. First, applications are not suitable. It's not defined what suitable means, and the second thing was the documentation is a double punishment for felonies, the policy states. This is something that's been going on for a while, and seemed like we're still back at the first time that I spoke about it, you know, from 2014 to 2017, and seemed like, you know, we sort of divided on how to amend this a different way. I mean, I know right is right, wrong is wrong, and I think, you know, not only the people here now, but there'll be more people coming speaking about this, because it don't take 3 years to change a policy, especially when it's not a state policy, a state rule, a state law. It's Lynchburg City Schools law. And I know the superintendent got a lot to do with it. If he wanted to change it or bring it to the board to mend it a different way. Because bottom line is undercover blackball, like I've been saying over the years. You cannot get your record sponge in Virginia. You can only get a pot. So somebody got a felony 20 years ago, can't even take the kids to a field trip for 2 hours. I mean, what's that saying? I mean, this is something we, you know, talking about over and over again. And I hope that y'all, you know, listen a little bit more closely to what I'm saying, what Doc was saying about, you know, we need to look at it and think about how can we change it. Let's work together and try to come up with some kind of solution where a person volunteer. It's passion to me because I have been in those child's shoes. This is my home. I love it. And I like working with young people, special, that looks like me. And I think I can get a little closer to some people. And I appreciate y'all's time, and I hope that y'all really consider changing this policy. You know, whereas people can go volunteer and try to help doing some of the things that have not been done. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Mr. Gonzalez.
Hi, my name is Vicente Gonzalez. I am an alumnus of EC Glass High School and a recent graduate of Virginia Commonwealth University. I'm here to address a memo that was released last week by Governor McAuliffe addressing changes in federal immigration policy, advising Virginia school districts on what to do if immigration and custom enforcement is to enter a school and how to manage those situations. The memo, which was released 05917, instructed schools that they are not permitted to ask immigration status when students enroll in schools. Undocumented students are only required to meet residency requirements to be able to enroll in a Lynchburg City School or Virginia City School, Virginia State School. Also, schools are not permitted to give over any information to Immigration and Customs Enforcement without parental consent or a subpoena or a court order. Schools have been advised to consult with their school division counsel or an immigration advisor to be prepared on what to do on these situations. Also, schools are encouraged to be prepared on what to do if a student's parents are facing deportation procedures. I myself was an undocumented student until my junior year in high school. I attribute most of my opportunities in life to my access to public education. Immigrant communities and undocumented people have been contributing to the city for over 30 years now, and students should have the right to a public education. I hope the school board is willing to work with our communities and to address this issue, which has already been addressed by Governor McAuliffe. I thank you for listening to me today, and I hope that something comes from this. Thank you.
Thank you.
I believe the last speaker is Mr. Hutcherson.
Good evening. I'm Gerard Hutcherson, and I want to speak to the issue of felons being disallowed from trips with their children or grandchildren or family members. And just want to speak about the negative aspects of that, in that so many of our families now are disconnected anyway, you know, the nuclear family, the extended family. And when a family member is away doing a sentence, the whole family is doing a sentence. And when that individual comes back and hopefully seeking to be a better citizen, not allowed to participate in some of the field trips and activities of their children because of their prior criminal record. Support of the student is vital for students by family members. When their family members are not present, it's a disconnect for them that they may feel they don't have the support, or they're somewhere unworthy or don't meet up to the level of other students, excuse me, whose parents or family members are allowed to participate in such activities. And we just feel strongly that it's imperative that felons who have worked to be good citizens be allowed to do that and not be disallowed because of a felony conviction. This allowing the parents and grandparents and family members to participate increases that student's confidence. When they see their parents there, whether it's a basketball game or a field trip or anything of that nature, their confidence is improved. They're more likely to do better in their schoolwork and also to be better behaved. They don't have those negative feelings that my parents are not good enough, I'm not good enough. We all want to feel like we're good enough or to know that we're good enough. We don't have to live down to anybody. We want to live up to the expectations and goals that we have and that God has given us. And so allowing felons to participate in the school life of their children is very important. Day by day, we seek to get better and not bitter as a community, as a family, as a church. And Lynchburg, we want Lynchburg to have the best school system ever in the country or anywhere else, and the best opportunities for our children to excel and to reach the levels that they are capable of reading. Thank you.
Thank you.
That concludes public comments. Brings us next to item B, the finance report. Mr. Buckles.
Mr. Braverman. Mr. Buckles. Good evening. My financial report this evening have two components. One is the update on the financial report. The first part that I'd like to do before we get into the financial report is, in previous years, we have brought the, after the audit has been completed, normally the audit partner would come and address the school board on the results of the financial audit. Normally we would have that around the same time it occurs at the city. This time we were a little bit late in getting the partner before you. So tonight we do have the partner, Chris Banton, who is the partner responsible for the audits of the schools in the city from Brown Edwards, to address the board on the results of the financial audit completed for 2015-2016. You have received the CAFA, I guess some time back we had issued the CAFA, the report that includes the audit of the schools into the city's financial report. So he will come at this time to address the board and answer any questions you may have as a result of the 2015-2016 financial audit.
Thanks for the introduction. As Anthony said, my name is Chris Banton. I'm with Brown Edwards. I'm the audit partner in charge of the entire city city audit engagement. And as you know, the schools is one of the largest self-contained components of that audit. So we like to present the results of the audit. As Anthony mentioned, we finished the audit issued it in December. So we're just going to culminate that process today with just going over the results at a pretty high level. But happy to answer any questions that you have. It is a long process. We'll kick off next year's audit in about 2 months. I'm sure Anthony doesn't really look forward to that, but we're going to get started on that. But I just want to go over it really high level right now. I don't believe anyone has the CAFR in front of them, but I'm just going to kind of talk through some of the audit results. The audit itself is composed of three significant components, and the first part being the primary focus of our engagement, which is to the audit of the financial statements. That audit includes the city and all of their activities, the schools, Greater Lynchburg Transit, and the Business Development Center, all the pieces of the city. And we provide an opinion on each of those significant components, which one of those, of course, is the schools. We issued what's called an unmodified opinion on the school's financial statements. That's the highest level of assurance that we can issue on a set of audited financials. So I just want to commend your staff for a clean audit once again this year. During one thing I will touch base on as part of the financial audit, there were no new standards this year. Last year when we were here, we were talking about the new pension standard that changed the way the
pension liability was reported. It used to be just disclosed in the back, and now it's on the primary financials. Your pension liability is this year is up to about $88 million. Just like to point that out. And it's one of the bigger numbers on your balance sheet. Second component of the audit is you are a government entity, so we look at your internal controls and your processes a little deeper than a small business. And we also have to perform compliance procedures that the Auditor of Public Accounts gives us. We report on that. We did not have any material weaknesses or significant deficiencies in your policies or processes, and we didn't have any findings in relations to the Auditor of Public Accounts procedures. And then the third component of our audit is auditing your federal awards. That's a backbone of a significant amount of your activities. On a cyclical basis, we select certain programs, and this year we selected Title I and Special Ed, pretty much two of your largest programs. The total federal awards we audited this year was $7 million of federal awards, which I think is that's about $7 million of a total $10 million. So a pretty significant component of the total city federal awards. As part of that testing, we have to actually audit your internal controls over those programs, and we perform significant compliance tests over those programs. If we had findings, we would have to report those to this governing body. We did not have any significant problems with your processes, your controls, or findings over compliance. Any questions on that? I'll really briefly touch base on two other documents that you should have received prior to this meeting. One is a letter from us as auditors directly to this governing body. It says those charged with governance. Basically, it explains to you what it took to get to that clean opinion. Very clean, very competent set of management you have here. So the letter itself is very clean. It does include some just things for you to understand of things that could go wrong during an audit but didn't go wrong during this audit. So that's there. And then the third letter you received from us is just a general letter on just some of the things that are coming down the pipeline related to financial reporting for local governments. The only significant one I will talk about is somewhat similar to the pension standards that came out last year. This has to do with your post-retirement health care benefits. The reporting model is changing in 2 years. Right now, there's an $8 million liability that's just disclosed. In 2 years, that $8 million liability is just going to show up on your balance sheet, just like pensions did 2 years ago. So nothing changes to the underlying plan, but just a different reporting model that you'll see in a couple years. And we'll talk about that, especially with the year that it's implemented.
Okay. All right, thank you. Other board member questions or comments?
Mr. Beckles, is it a true statement? This is now our sixth straight year of receiving a clean, fifth straight year of receiving a clean audit for our school financials. So thank you, Mr. Beckles, for your leadership. We really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Okay, I think there's, thank you.
All right, thank you.
I guess you had a clean audit here too. So.
Thank you.
Mr. Beckles.
Now I will go over the financial statements for the 7 months ended December 31st, 2017. As far as our revenues are concerned, again, no significant issues there. I would draw your attention to the revised revenue forecast. Last month I gave you one. This month I'm giving you one also. If you turn to the back of page 6, basically you'll see that the revenue shortfall right now is projected at 502. And the major reason for that is the $74,000 we got for an insurance claim. So it doesn't, that $74,000 of the $104,000 increase, I would say, from last month, the insurance claim payment that we got is going to pay for the expenses that we've incurred as a result of the damage to one of our buildings. So that's not really going to be an increase in revenue, per se. It's going to be an offset. So basically, we're back to our $602,000 revenue shortfall. At this point, there's nothing really we can do about it until we see after enrollment for March 31st. But at this point, I'm not too concerned with the $600,000 shortfall when we look as far as matching the budget side of it, because we do have where I can we can hold off on some things that won't have a significant impact on the operation. So I'm not too concerned that we are not able to cover that at this point. If that changes, obviously I'll bring that to your attention, but I don't foresee that at this point. Okay. As far as the expenses goes, again, no significant issues. You would notice there in transportation, there are three lines that are over budget. I think I pointed this out to you in January. It's still here in February. I would expect it to be there a little bit more for the next couple months. One of the reasons why I'm not adjusting it at this point, because I don't know exactly what the total amount is going to be. I expect it to be over a little bit more. I do expect fuel to cost us a little bit more. If you notice, the available balance in that account is $66,000 total. So I'm just going to let it ride a little bit more. And then when we are a little bit more confident with what the adjustment needs to be, then I will bring that to you. But at this point, I'm not too concerned about it. We know what they are and why they are over budget. But again, as we get closer, I will request a budget reallocation to cover that. But I don't want to be doing one now and one later. So just to make you aware that I am aware of the fact that it is negative, but we'll address it later on in the year. Okay. As far as the expenses go, there are no significant items or changes that I'm concerned about that I need to bring to your attention.
Okay. Board member questions, comments? Ms. Carter.
The supplemental lottery per pupil lot allocation.
Beg about it?
The supplemental lottery per pupil, mm-hmm. It's only received like 9%. So does that come in at different times? Or
most, the majority of the state money comes in the last 6 months, I should say. It comes in from now until June. Most of the state money does that. So you would find that those percentages of the amount received are a little bit under the 50% in some cases. That's because between now and June is when we get the most of that money.
Thank you.
Other questions, comments? I guess I have a question. At this point in the budget and your tracking, what's the biggest uncertainty in terms of total potential budget impact in terms of like a one item? Is it the ADM uncertainty or?
I'm a little bit more concerned about the sales tax piece.
Okay.
If the sales tax comes in as they previously budgeted, this is here, you see a soft floor of 278, so let's call it 300,000. Like I said, in the last 4 years, despite what they forecast, in some cases, most years, they forecast it coming in lower. We've always made it, so assuming it's going to be 5 years in a row. Then we'll go back up 300,000. That means we'll only be short 300,000 on the state revenue. I'm not too concerned with 300,000. So that would be my, if there's one item that I'm a little bit more concerned about is whether or not we'll hit the sales tax revenue number. That goes back up, we'll be okay. If it doesn't and everything else stays as is, the way we plan it, we'll still be okay. Now, if something explodes, it's a different story. Game over on that one, it'll be a different story. But as of what we know now, I'm not too concerned now, but I am watching it.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Okay. Thank you. So that brings us to the consent agenda, which includes the school board meeting minutes for February 21st, a regular meeting, the personnel report and addendum, a religious exemption, and then policy EBCB safety drills.
So moved.
Moved and seconded, all in favor? Aye. Okay, thank you. That brings us to student representative comments. Ms. Page, go to the floor.
Senior player Caleb Sneed scored his 1,000th career point during the game against Allegheny on February 21st. He won the game 101-88 and moved on to face Spotswood on Thursday, February 23rd. The team then moved on to the state championship against George Wythe High School on March 2nd at VCU. They played a hard game but came up short. We congratulate them for a great season. And these are pictures from the Allegheny game, Caleb receiving his 1,000th point, and our game at VCU. HHS graduates. Congratulations to the most recent graduates of HHS, Danielle Callahan, Olivia Dorn, Micah Halestock, and Catherine Marquez. Alumni basketball. On Saturday, April 8, 2017, the class of 2007 will host a HHS alumni basketball game in the new gymnasium at Heritage to raise money for their class reunion. All alumni may participate. Track. On February 24th, Trayvon Cash set a new state record in the triple jump at the Group 3A Indoor Track and Field Championships at Roanoke College. Continued. Congratulations to the boys team for finishing fourth in the state track meet. Pink hair. Assistant Principal Kenya Flower is raising money for the Blue Ridge Area Susan G. Komen organization. She's been wearing a pink wig this week. Odyssey of the Mind. Congratulations to the two Odyssey of the Mind teams who won first and third place in their respective categories on March 5th in the regional tournament. The team consisting of Paisley Williams, Iris Williams, Muhammad Tahir, Josh Lynn, Matthew Rowe, and Ian Garland will advance to the state competition on April 1st at John Champ High School. The Memory Project. Art students at Heritage produced 22 portraits of Syrian refugee children and were shipped to the kids in December of 2016. The Memory Project sent Mr. Rourke and his students a video of the kids receiving their portraits. They are now working on portraits of Tanzanian orphans. Rising 8th graders. Heritage hosted Rising 8th Grader Night for our future pioneers. We welcome them. Intercession. Heritage had over 125 students attend intercession. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Always appreciate the updates.
So that brings us to school board committee reports. Are there any committees reporting? Dr. Coleman.
I would like to report for the record that the Equity Task Force met. There was a robust discussion. Dr. Brabrand was present. Our chair of the school board was present, and many of the persons weighed in. Measurably speaking, last year we had some challenges. This year, grateful to Cindy for posting the events for February. And as we continue to get better at getting better, I think we've got better. We're getting better, I should say. And so there's a lot of positive interventions that are taking place through that task force. And I say that verbally because there are concrete things, obviously, that are coming out of that. But since we have a committee and that is committee supposed to report, I wanted to verbalize those things. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Other committee reports. Okay, thank you. That brings us to item F, unfinished business. It's the middle school program of studies for 2017-18. This is for action tonight. Dr. McLean.
Yes, thank you. We brought forth to the board at our last meeting the proposed middle school program of studies that has minimal changes from the one approved a year ago by the board. We provided you then an additional updated copy at the end of last week where there were just some charts and other minor adjustments from the copy you'd received last time. So it's brought back to the board this evening for consideration.
Okay. Are there board member questions, comments? And this is for action tonight. What's the board's pleasure?
I move that we adopt the
middle school program studies.
Okay.
Is there any additional discussion? No? Okay. So the motion for the board is to approve the middle school program studies for 2017-18. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Thank you. Brings us to new business, item G1. Policy 2CB-R and 2CC-R guidelines for community resource persons and school volunteers. This is for information tonight, planned for action at our next meeting on the 21st. Dr. Brabrand.
Good evening. Good evening, Dr. Nellis, members of the Lynchburg City School Board, staff members. Equity Task Force members, community members. I want to present to you tonight our school volunteer policy, what our policy is, the research we've done around this policy, our conclusions, and a recommendation that I would share with this board tonight to move us forward on this issue. And a final point, not directly related to the school volunteer policy, but important of what parents may do. There are two central components to our policy. First, a volunteer applicant will not be allowed to volunteer until a background check is complete and they have been approved in the Raptor system. Information received from that, if information received from that background check of a volunteer results in a discovery that the applicant's not suitable to serve as a volunteer in Lynchburg City Schools, a letter would be sent from my office notifying the building principal and the potential volunteer. All volunteers do serve at the discretion of the superintendent. Our current policy says that anyone convicted of a felony offense will be disqualified from volunteer activity. Anyone convicted of a misdemeanor may be disqualified depending on the nature of the offense or the volunteer activity. The second component of our volunteer policy talks about volunteer assistant athletic coaches and coaches paid by third-party organizations. They must be screened according to the procedures for all of our Lynchburg City School employees and have a full background check. That's our policy. Part of what I wanted to bring tonight is looking at what local and regional counties and cities have done and what our research is in that area. We looked at both counties and cities, and I'm going to share with you snippets from that review. One local county said they do not allow convicted felons to be volunteers or chaperones. Another said the school division may decline the services of a volunteer chaperone for any reason, and they cited their policy 2CB2CC. Another local county that the applications reviewed at central office, applicants self-report convictions, criminal charges, and any DSS findings, and they reserve the right to reject any applicant. Another local county with another policy has criminal background checks may be required. Volunteers are approved by the principal, and principals have the authority to terminate the volunteer services. Any volunteer may be subject to school board approval. Another county, we do not allow anyone with the felony to volunteer or coach. Another county, the applicant self-reports on conviction of a felony. A local comparative city reserves the right at all times to refuse or terminate volunteer service. Applicant self-reports on felonies, crimes of moral turpitude, and crimes against children. Another comparative city, volunteers must be checked through the sex offender registry. Applicant self-reports on crimes against children. Another city, applicant self-reports on felonies, misdemeanors, and crimes against children. Anyone convicted of a misdemeanor or felony offense, especially an offense against a minor, may be disqualified from volunteering. And another city, volunteers may be subject to background, criminal record, and reference checks to the same extent as school division employees. Finally, two final cities that we compared. HR conducts the complete background investigation for those volunteers that will be working unsupervised with students. They apply the same standard for employment with respect to felonies to approving volunteers. A volunteer may be removed from participation at any time with or without cause. And a final city, when convicted of a misdemeanor offense, especially an offense against a minor, may be disqualified from volunteering. Anyone convicted of a felony offense will not be eligible to volunteer. Our conclusions from that, no school division specifically endorses individuals with felony records to serve as volunteers. Some divisions have a self-reporting mechanism. Self-reporting takes away from consistent policy implementation and increases the risk of incomplete and inaccurate information, I acknowledge that there are some divisions that have done this. In fact, my own belief is that in years past in our own system, we had an informal practice that led to inconsistent policy and inconsistent application and inconsistent consistency. Finally, the purpose of a volunteer policy is to ensure student safety first. But it's also important to ensure community clarity and individual fairness. I've spent a lot of time reviewing this for the board. I've spent time listening in the community, listening through the Equity Task Force, and I present to you tonight this policy with one revision. The revision would be as follows. However, anyone who would be disqualified as a volunteer by virtue of their criminal record may request that the superintendent make an exception, who may grant the exception under whatever conditions he or she sets, if the following conditions are met. Number one, the disqualifying conviction occurred more than 15 years before the date the exception is sought, and the criminal background check reflects no other significant convictions. The second condition that would be met would be that no conviction was for a barrier crime, and that term is defined in Virginia Code Section 63.2.17.19. And the third element of this revision would be, in the sole discretion of the superintendent, there's a belief that the person does not present a threat to the safety or welfare of the students in the program or activity for which the exception is sought. In the event the superintendent denies the request for an exception, the individual may appeal in writing within 15 days to the school board, and the school board would review and make a final determination within 30 days of the written appeal or as soon thereafter as possible. One of the things I recognize in this community, as I said a moment ago, that years before we formalized our volunteer policy, we had informal practices that were inconsistent and left people feeling that the division sent a mixed message. I take responsibility for that history and legacy in our school system, and I feel the revision I brought you tonight works to address that. But what I also recognize through this review of the volunteer policy is we've not been clear about what our parents, even our parents with felony records, what they may do, what they can do, and what they should do in our school system. They can at any time have lunch with their child. They can and should attend their child's awards assembly. We've been doing far more outreach over the last several years for parent engagement, muffins for moms, donuts for dads. Heck, even one school this year is doing, I think it's graham crackers for grandmas. We want all of our parents, regardless of their background, to be a part of their child's education. They could come as a participant at field day. They can come to evening school events. They can come to our school's book fairs. We want our parents to be involved, no matter what. As I reflect on the school volunteer policy, I recognize that we balance competing interests. One, we need to be sure that we are being proactive for students' safety and security. That remains paramount in our school division. We also, to the greatest degree possible, have a responsibility to deliver a message of inclusion to our community who supports our students, our schools, and our school system. Last night, I got to be at the city's State of the City address, where the mayor and vice mayor talked about redefining parent engagement. I believe, as I said earlier, that we've got to be clear in communicating about what our parents can do regardless of their background. That does not fall even with under the auspices of the volunteer policy. And we will do a better job moving forward in communicating through school administration at the division school level what parents can do. But I also recognize our community wants to help and support our schools too. This is a topic that has had strong feelings in our community for some time, as you've heard tonight and you've heard over the last couple of years. I believe tonight I've brought you a revision that balances the safety needs of our students along with our continued work that we've elevated even more so this year with our equity guidelines to create a community and a culture of inclusiveness in our school system. This is my attempt as superintendent to strike the right balance between these issues while making sure that student safety remains our top concern. I look forward to the board discussion that takes place tonight and moving forward, and I believe we can move forward on this issue in a way that builds our school system and builds our community. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Brabrand. Dr. Dolan-Sewell.
Yes, thank you very much. I appreciate that administration has done a lot of work in looking into this topic and coming up with a policy that does allow for the possibility of people with felony convictions, certain felony convictions, to volunteer. Just wanted to ask for the public, could you please clarify the definitions, the barrier crime, what that means, and what other agencies, if you will, use that?
Right, and we can work to get a link up so that the public, the community, can link to that code to see that list. I don't know whether it's in the interest of the board for discussion. There is a when you go to the Virginia Code, there are a set of definitions around what barrier crimes are. I don't know if the board would like, I could kind of go through a couple. I mean, I don't know whether that's, you have a link to it? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Childress. And all right, you're at the Google site. I don't know where 63.
Search it by the code section. Yeah,
it's down below here.
Yeah. There's the
code numbers.
What are the code numbers?
Yeah, it's 63.2.17.19.
Dash 17.19.
1719. I think what I'll do for purposes of, I mean, we're not going to read through all of these tonight. Some, or I guess we'll do what the board wants to do. Let me just read from a few of them if that's the spirit of this. They would include felony violations around murder or manslaughter, malicious wounding by a mob, abduction, robbery, carjacking, extortion by threat, threats of death, felony stalking, arson, drive-by shootings, use of a machine gun or a sawed-off shotgun, crimes against nature involving children, incest, indecent liberties with children, abuse and neglect of children, failure to secure medical attention for a child, some obscenity offenses that are specifically related to another code, which I won't go in through right now, possession of child pornography or electronic facilitation of pornography, abuse and neglect of incapacitated adults, employing or permitting a minor to assist in an act that would constitute an offense under Article 5, another code section relevance, delivery of drugs to prisoners, escape from jail, felonies by prisoners,
or equivalent offenses in another state of the felonies by prisoners. So some of the most serious and significant felonies would be excluded in the policy revision that I've shared with you tonight. What's not in here, or maybe for just the public and for discussion of board, what's not in here is felony convictions on theft, felony convictions on drugs, which are two areas, for example, in Virginia, where there are large numbers of people that have those felony backgrounds.
Dr. Dolan, so.
Another point of clarification is that a class six felony could actually be multiple misdemeanors. So you could have somebody who was 20 years old and had two convictions for shoplifting and end up with a felony conviction. You could also end up with a felony conviction. A person could be any age, or for this example, say 23, and they had public intoxication and failed to make their court date with the judge, and they automatically get contempt and they now have a felony on their record. So, you know, we've talked about the exclusions for volunteers, which are the most egregious and serious of crimes, but it's also important to remember that, you know, one can be convicted of a felony in Virginia for very relatively minor things.
If I could, for Dr. Dolan Sewell, I think you mentioned shoplifting a moment ago. Mm-hmm. So Virginia's threshold for felonies around theft is at $200, which is a lower number when you do a state-by-state comparison. So theft would not be a barrier crime under the policy I brought you tonight, nor would felony offenses regarding drugs, except as the specific one I outlined to you a moment ago, the delivery of drugs to prisoners as set out in a specific part of the code. So those are areas under this revision that could be reviewed by the superintendent.
And just one more on the felony for theft. The $200 limit is multiple occasions. So for example, I sat on a grand jury within the last couple years. There was a young mother who would occasionally shoplift from a local grocery store. Each of those shoplifting events were under $50, but once she hit $200, she now has a felony conviction. And this was a young mom shoplifting, you know, knew she shouldn't be doing that, but she's now got a felony record.
Dr. Coleman.
Thank you, Dr. Dolan Sewell. I believe that this is one of the more significant human rights issues that has come before the board since I have been a member of the board. And I think that Dr. Brabrand, you have in your preparation been very keen in helping us to understand better what parents may do. And you listed six, and there may well be more than six. And to get that out will certainly help parents with felonies to better engage. The spirit of the policy is dealing with volunteers. And the word volunteer simply means, at its most basic form, is to take part in something, a task, to participate freely, to offer themselves to do something. It would appear to me, having also attended last night's State of the City address, which in my personal opinion, I've never been prouder of being a Lynchburger than last night, to witness the incredible direction our city is moving to attack poverty at a rate of 24%, with some 30% of that 24% being children. And that there is a spirit that we can solve our problems with persons engaging. So volunteerism apparently is going to be something quintessentially important in our city. Therefore, when we have a volunteer policy that relates to the schools, that denies individuals the opportunity to freely participate, we're sending mixed messages, in my personal opinion. So therefore, the current policy as it is, anything would be better than what it is. These distinguished members around the board, I trust that we'll find some way to come to agreement around whatever that may be that's better than what we have now, which totally excludes volunteerism of those who have committed some of the most minor of felony charges. Obviously, we would all remove the barrier pieces, and obviously the superintendent has done that. It would appear to me, Mr. Chair, I don't know the appropriateness of this, certainly not interested in wasting any unnecessary money, but if we have an equity task force, for example, if we've had listening tours in the past, wouldn't it be appropriate before we make a decision to really get an opportunity, rather than just the few who silently may get emails, to be influenced one way or the other? Have an opportunity to hear what our community really believes around this issue of volunteerism in Lynchburg with our public schools. And the last thing I would have to say, as we seek to try to get better somewhere, and I commend you for the courage, Mr. Superintendent, to stand before us and bring some effort in that direction. Is 15 years absolutely necessary to get by? To what signal are we saying about the spirit of volunteerism in our city when persons with the most minor of concocted policies intended for deeper purposes than what the law may on the surface suggest will not be able to participate in the process of volunteering to help us get better as a city and as a school division? I'm slightly concerned about that piece. 15, 10, 5, 3, 2. So I guess I'm asking at the end of the day, Mr. Chair, before this board ever makes a decision in keeping with the wisdom of the veterans on the board, would this be a time to see what the community has to say about such an issue before we would make a determination that would really send a signal to the whole spirit of where it seems our city is going with community engagement, parental engagement, us working together to help address some of our most basic problems in our city? And I would also argue, as I begin to do and have done my own research, that other communities are stepping out in that direction. And it does seem that they're having positive results from it.
Other questions or comments? Ms. Carter.
I was happy to hear Dr. Dolan-Sewell bring out the point regarding Virginia, the state of Virginia, and the $200 felony charges and how that can be an aggregate amount of money or different times, because I know often there will be rumors that felons are everywhere in the schools just volunteering, and we're not talking about the ones that have barrier crimes. We're talking about people that may have two or three charges that they've never paid. Isn't that one of the examples you gave too, that you could have two or three convictions, or not convictions, but
misdemeanors,
and they all of a sudden now you have a felony charge? But again, also you have the other side where family members or mothers or parents are concerned regarding the change in this policy. So there has to be a balance that we strike here. And just to even tackle this issue, it's a brave one and it's courageous, and we really do need to look at this. But there's always two sides to it also.
Other questions, comments?
I really was looking for some direction, Mr. Chair, around how we proceed from here over against just arbitrarily deciding on the 21st of March. And as I was further thinking, if we also are concerned about helping make a way out for people in poverty. And if there is a correlation between poverty and maybe the inability to successfully find employment, et cetera, for whatever the reasons may be, certainly a felony charge could create obstruction to that. What are we saying to individuals who we're saying, we want you to help yourself get out? And then at the same time, we're saying, over the most minor of things, that you have no value.
Well, as far as your comment about further direction, that's a board decision as to what direction the board decides they would like to go in.
I'm asking the board to give thought to how we would do that.
Dr. Dolenzel.
I was waiting to see if other people had other... Okay.
Mine's not so much a question as a thought. As we were talking about, I was kind of thinking along the lines of what Dr. Coleman was saying is, you know, usually we have the first week information is presented to us and then we have some discussion and then, you know, the next meeting we vote on it. I feel there may be others in the community once presented with this information would like to come and speak to us and send us emails and however they would like to do that. So I would appreciate even a little bit more, only another meeting or so, just to have the rest of the community digest the information, get back to us. If administration feels reaching out in a phone call, please send us email, however they would do that. You know, I know the listening tours are a little extensive and tend to seem to bring about the same persons. So however we could get the information out to the community, I'm sure people will be reading about it in the paper and would like to get back to us, but I would like a little bit more time to think about it and receive input from the community.
Other, Ms. Mason.
I think I agree with Ms. Snyder. I know personally I'm starting to get some feedback from community members, and I would like an opportunity just to hear what the community has to say. I mean, I know that we all have our personal feelings, but since we are here to represent, you know, the best interest of the community, I think we can only do so until we hear from them.
So it was Dr. Dolenzel.
I was just going to say I agree wholeheartedly. I think this is a very, very significant and to me a very important critical issue that we're discussing, and to make a change like this, I do think we need to hear from the community, and the community needs to be educated. If you just use the word felony, right, without talking about what that really means, it's very scary. And our first concern, this board and the administration, our first concern is for the safety of our children, right? That's the number one thing, and we all agree upon that. You know, the speakers before us all agree that the safety of our children is first and foremost, right? For some of us, though, we also recognize that we are missing really valuable volunteers in our system, and the part of the reason that we're missing that, you know, is actually due to systemic racism. You know, I hate to, you know, I don't mean to stir up controversy, but this is the reality. You look at the rates for smoking marijuana between African Americans and white people in our country, very similar rates. However, African Americans are 3.7 more times likely than white people to be arrested, even though we have the same rates. When black people are arrested for a crime, they are convicted more often than white people committing the same crime. 35% of drug arrests are of African Americans, but 46% of convictions of drug arrests are of African Americans. So we are basically, with our policy as it sits right now, we are basically participating in a system that is, you know, we are allowing volunteers in that are white that might have engaged in the same behaviors and been arrested, but they were not convicted, you know, in part due perhaps to the color of their skin. So I'm just suggesting that this is important. I mean, the safety of our kids comes first and foremost. This policy, you know, represents, a consideration of this policy represents consideration of much larger issues, you know, in our community, in our world today. And I do think it's brave and it's controversial, and there are people who are going to be upset about it, but I'm really proud of this board for agreeing to take it on.
Dr. Cena?
I would echo that, and also add to it that
I think a lot of these affect communities of poverty more than the general public. And so it's sort of a double whammy, if you will, on the very populations that we're trying to reach out to, vis-a-vis the focus on poverty of the city and the challenges that we face in our school system that are tied to some of the symptoms and outcomes of poverty as they relate to children's education and parental involvement and the whole criminal justice system.
Ms. Snyder?
I want to thank administration for taking a look at this. One of the things we talked about at the Equity Symposium I went to is that, yes, we're school board members, but this is, if we want to be an equitable district and division, it's up to us to look at these policies and to tackle these uncomfortable subjects. So I thank administration for taking the stand and saying, you know, looking at all these other communities around us that are very willing to just say no, 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 and we could have stuck with that. But we're going to take a look at this, and we want to hear from everybody, and we want to talk about it. We want to do right on our community.
So, Dr. Coleman.
I want to redact my earlier statement and also say I have never been prouder to be a Lynchburger on the school board. I want to say this as school board member Katie Snyder just indicated. I think Virginia needs bold leadership. One of the reasons why we may not be able to pay our teachers as we should, some of the challenges that we're getting ready to face with the budgetary constraints, is because there are not articulative expressions of advocacy for causes that really matter. And we are allowing ourselves to give way to those who are really anti-public education to determine how we go about doing what we do. And so the statements that I've heard around this table, I am just overwhelmed with joy. I believe that Lynchburg is being called to set the pace. What I saw last night from our mayor and our vice mayor is suggesting that Lynchburg is no longer going to be a thermometer, just going with whatever the temperature is being set. But we're seeking to be thermostats and determine what the temperature is going to be and to lead others, whether it be school divisions or localities, municipalities, to do what needs to be done in keeping with every child by name and need to graduation. I think we have to start thinking that way in Lynchburg in order for us to truly help the Commonwealth of Virginia to be a Commonwealth.
And what is the board's pleasure regarding the right now scheduled vote on the 21st? Since there seems to be a consensus to push it off for till the next meeting, or
I guess I don't like the concept of pushing it off as much as
gathering
the information. I want the community. I hope that the community will have an opportunity to weigh in, be that through SurveyMonkey, through Connected, and if there is enough information that we feel ready to make a decision, I would be comfortable with doing that. If not, you know, I think we need to hear enough from the community that we feel that we are making the best decision we can for our district.
Well, we always have the option to further try to get additional information. So we're not locked in from that standpoint.
Administration can certainly work to create a short survey that could be out, much like we did for the school calendar, to capture community feedback. And to the degree that the board would want, of course, at the next meeting, there are public comments that could be about any topic, including this one, until the board feels that they've really heard sufficiently from the community. In some ways, where we are right now, we're almost in the last leg of this school year. I think the board, of course, can decide what it wants, but when it wants to implement the policy, many policies often get implemented just like our discipline policies. We were here last year dealing with discipline. We did a lot of work. We had work sessions here in the spring We finished the work over the summer to prepare to be ready to implement them for next school year. The board might want to consider a similar timeline as it works on this, which gives a little bit more time to make sure you feel you've heard sufficiently from who you need to hear from to make a decision.
Dr. Dolan.
I was just going to say, because the next step would also be the development of the regulations, which would include guidelines for the to help the superintendent with the exception process.
Correct.
And that would definitely take, you know, significant work and discussion. It seems to me.
Yeah. Dr. Coleman.
I guess in the spirit of asking for guidance on this is, I just, you know, everyone may or may not have the courage to speak as our vice chair of the school board just spoke. And I was simply trying to see how can we take it away from a backroom discussion where people have the ability to be able to weigh in, but not be in an environment where there can be some honest discussion about our fears. And I have brought to this board numerous times in the past about school safety. I'm an advocate of that. So at the same time, a kid feels safe when there's somebody in front of him or her who can relate to the journey that they're on and can relate to the types of things that that person may be saying to them that they can't get in any other way. And that kid will be safe to not go in one direction and go into another direction with that type of interaction. So I'm just saying is, the more we can have these good, healthy dialogues before we make a decision, because I feel as though, and it makes sense to me, that this board must protect the safety of our students. I understand that. At the same time, who's really doing the influence? And is that influence out of fear? Or is that influence out of what really makes the best sense to help us to achieve the mission that we have of every child by name and need to graduation? And sometimes I feel like we're operating out of fear and pandering than out of what really is best for kids.
Okay. What do we want to do? We want to, I guess, defer the vote. Do we want to instruct administration to do some, set up a survey and gather some public input? Do we want something formal? Do we want to do just informal, just advertise it, you know, rely on input that we happen to get from people that are passionate about this?
I would ask for administration, if they're directed to do a survey, to do it, to administer it, to review it, and to prepare. I would love at least an additional board meeting beyond the next board meeting.
You need a month.
To have the survey, yeah. To conduct it, to review it, and have it in a presentable fashion. So I would love, if that's what the board chooses, not to have to bring that to you at the next board meeting, but at the board meeting at the beginning of April.
Can we have consensus on that, or, yeah? Okay, so I guess gather some public input and it'll come back to us in
First board meeting in April, okay?
Okay, so that's a month. Okay, okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
That brings us to item G2, capital improvement plan for William Marvin Bass Elementary School. Mr. Copeland, this comes to us for information tonight.
Yes, sir. Bass Elementary School is the next roof on our capital improvement plan roof replacement schedule. We released bids about a month ago and received the 6 bids that you see on the agenda item. The administration is recommending AAR of North Carolina for $189,900. They are the same roofing contractor that did all 3 phases of the roof at EC Glass High School.
Okay, board member questions or comments? Seems pretty straightforward. Is this something
consent agenda?
Put on the consent agenda?
Yes.
Please.
Yes, please.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
So it brings us to item H, superintendent's comments.
Thank you, Dr. Nellis. Several things. We got a lot going on right now in this school system. History Day is coming up at CVCC March 18th. Our school winners are going to be going to this next level of competition. And we're really excited about our History Day programming here in Lynchburg City, and we're confident they're going to have our kids do well there and then move on to the State History Day. Breakfast with the Superintendent is coming up next Thursday at 7:30. I don't know whether there are any tables left, but certainly work with the LCS Education Foundation. There's a link on our website to see if there's any tables or spots left. We'd love to have you out. It will be about the LCS classroom of 2017. So what's the latest? Many of you were in classrooms, but in prior years, what does it look like now? What's the same and what might be different? This very week, we have, later this week, we're partnering with the UP Foundation to premiere a film called Generation Found, which really talks about opioid addiction. That's become a significant issue around Virginia. It's being debated in the Virginia General Assembly. We know it's not affecting all kids, but the kids that it is affecting, it's having serious impacts on communities and families and those students. And so we want to partner with local experts to bring this issue. We hope many of you will come. It'll be at the Miller Center at 7 o'clock. We also have next week, when we have the superintendent breakfast in the morning, in the evening, we will have Ted Dintersmith. He is the producer, executive producer of a film that won at the Tribeca Film Festival, other film festivals most likely to succeed. Really talking about the future of education. What will it look like and how can we be innovative, creative? He is a non-traditional candidate in education. He was the most successful venture capitalist in America from 1995 to 1999. But his passion has become education, and I think it's highly appropriate as we're talking about our challenges in the city to bring in a national thought leader to look at this work. And that will be at Heritage High School in the auditorium on Thursday at 7 o'clock. And we really hope all the public will come out. Earlier that week, on Monday, we'll actually have the film available for screening. And it is also, I believe, at 7 o'clock. We know one of the things I wanted to also share with you, I got a lot of things to share. I promise I'm going to try to be brief. We want to notify our community tonight of our intent to apply for Title IV Part B 21st Century Community Learning Center funds. And we want our community to know this. They're competitive grant funds designed to provide academic and enrichment programming outside the regular school day. The grants support family engagement and literacy programs. We'll be submitting applications to continue our 21st century programming at Perrymont, R.S. Payne, T.C. Miller, and Lincoln Middle. Community members wishing to review or comment on these grant proposals may contact Mike Rutter, our Director of School Improvement and Grants, or Sarah Campbell, our Coordinator for Extended Learning Time, and you can get their contact information on our website. We have talked at the school board about the importance of doing culturally responsive instruction and equity training. That is happening this week. Our new teacher center is going to be with all of our principals and instructional coaches going over equity training, culturally responsive instruction as part of a full day workshop. So we're excited about that work. The VDOE, the Office of School Improvement, we've been sharing with you updates each month about our schools that are facing accreditation challenges. They're going to be here next week working with the two schools that are denied accreditation, but also a couple of our schools that are still in that are still short of full accreditation. So we're looking forward to that dialogue and discussion. parent engagement we've been talking about all night, and we will have another parent workshop this Saturday at 9 a.m. at College Hill Community Center, and the topic, respect and disrespect from the parent's perspective. I hope many in the community will come out for that. Again, 9 a.m. at College Hill Community Center, respect and disrespect from the parent's perspective. You may have seen this week front page news about drones are the future. Soon they may be delivering burritos, hamburgers, and newspapers. And our kids are at the forefront of getting the skill set at not just operating a drone, but building a drone. So during intercession, our IT folks worked with kids from both Glass and Heritage. I want to thank Mr. Childress, our director for IT, and Mr. Quell, and others who were involved in making that happen. And it was a wonderful opportunity to get our kids additional skill sets. We've talked about behavior over the course of several months with this board. I want you to know we just finished doing PBIS behavior for our bus drivers. We had done some earlier last year, and we've done follow-up training now this year, and the feedback on it was very positive. I want to thank Ms. Brown for that. We have also begun training on restorative practices, a workshop that we did with administrators and teachers about how to look at restorative justice as a alternative path to discipline in our schools. Another way to get the results of students behaving at the high expectations we have. Finally, I just want to say our thoughts and prayers are with Sandusky Elementary School. Byron Davis, our custodian there, passed away this week, and our thoughts and families are with the Davis family. Thank you.
Thank you. Other board member comments. Ms. Mason.
I had an opportunity to get out and visit some of the schools during intercession, specifically EC Glass, and that was a really great visit. I was excited to visit the Beacon of Hope Future Center. They were doing SAT prep, and it was really nice to see the partnership. So kudos to them, and I hope that all of our EC Glass students are taking advantage of the good work that they do in the Future Center.
Other board member comments, question? Okay, Ms. Carter.
I just want to again thank Mr. Beckles for all his efforts for making sure that we have clean water and for keeping the finances straight, because your money has to be right. We as the board really appreciate that.
The money doesn't get, if the money's not right, we all pay.
Yes, we do.
Unfortunately, Mr. Buckles.
Thank you.
Dr.
Bowman. I was delighted last evening to see persons like school board member Susan Morrison making comments about persons who were receiving the Mayor's Award of Excellence, and all of the individuals that were honored at some point, it seemed to be something that they were doing, interacting with the schools. And so it's just a good thing to see that the community has the well-being of our schools on their mind, and we certainly encourage all of that as much as we can.
That brings us to item J, informational items. The next school board meeting is scheduled for Tuesday, March 21st at 5:30 p.m. here in the boardroom. With that, the meeting's adjourned.